Gentlemen, start your engines!
Vi är inne i det allra heligaste i Stockholm-världen, enligt mitt mått mätt i alla fall. Vi är inne i någonting som heter Holman Moody, och det är egentligen ett företag som härstammar ifrån legendariska Holman Moody. Och vi ska prata med Lee Holman, son till den kände profilen John Holman, som jobbade och var egentligen kung ibland stockcars under 60-talet. Lee Holman, you got a nice operation here.
Thank you.
I really like it. Could you tell us a little about the heritage from your father and Holman Moody and the cars they built?
Holman and Moody actually started in 1957 when Ford had a racing program in North Carolina, and it was not very successful, and they hired my father to come in and act as the managing director of the Ford factory team. Dad took over Peter DiPaolo Engineering, and late in 57, the factories decided to get out of racing, and so they took a move of banning factory support from any of the NASCAR races. And as such, the Ford factory team had to be sold, and they sold it to my father. It became Holman and Moody, and they just continued on racing. They used the cars and the spare engines, spare pieces that DiPaolo Engineering had. In 57, 58, they started building their own cars. And by 1959, they actually set up a factory and built in a row 9 Thunderbirds for the 59 series. And it became a factory. It changed from the typical race team was 3 or 4 guys building a race car, and Holman and Moody became a factory manufacturing race cars very quickly. And by 1962, we were building 25 or 30 race cars a year, selling the components, selling the parts to anybody that wanted to come in. By then, the Ford factory, the Ford money had come back in, so we were getting the Ford money pump switched on, which provided race engine components and things that a team couldn't afford to buy at that time. And so by 1965, we had 350 employees in a 150,000 square foot building, and we had one customer, Ford Motor Company.
That sounds great, and that was when the big time started, I guess, around 64,
yes.
65.
Yes, but Holman and Moody was a little bit funny in that they were so successful as a race team that Ford took the approach, they treated us kind of like hitmen. They would say, go win this race, go attack the Monte Carlo Rally, go do this, go do that. And we would put a team together, we would organize it so that we would win. And overall, we only won 25% of the races we entered, but we finished in the top 10 75% of the time.
You said something about Monte Carlo Rally. It wasn't only the NASCAR races, it was other kinds of races too?
We did the Monte Carlo Rally, we did the mobile economy run for Ford Motor Company, we did a lot of different activities. We were involved a little bit in the Indianapolis 500. We were involved in boat racing, quite active. We did the Baja races in California, in Southern California. We basically ran any sort of performance event. When NASCAR outlawed the single overhead cam engine, we had all those engines, so we built the FX Mustangs, which became the funny cars. So we actually invented the funny cars. And in every class, every step of racing, our cars won. You have the famous 63 Galaxies that ran in Europe and were dominant. Those were Holman and Moody cars. We used, and my father was very good about finding good people. And one of the best was Alan Mann of Alan Mann Racing in England. And he subcontracted some of the Monte Carlo work for us and was involved in the Le Mans GT40 program that we got involved with later. But basically, we were the Ford factory team from 1958 to 1972, when Henry Ford got completely out of racing again.
You mentioned the 40 program there.
Yes.
That was kind of a special year, 66 and 67, I guess.
It was special for us and special for me. I had been to Europe in 65 working with the Cobra Daytona Coupes that Alan Mann was racing for Cobra, for Ford Motor Company. Holman and Moody was brought in because in 65, the GT40 project had not been very successful. And Holman and Moody had a record of success. And so we were given the GT40 Mark II program by Ford Motor Company, and we were told to do what we could. Very few people know, at the time, Shelby American, Carroll Shelby, was owned by Ford Motor Company. And we were there doing the project, and Shelby was getting the press and getting the recognition for it, when in fact Holman and Moody performed most of the functions.
But what happened in the Le Mans 1967?
In 67, the Mark IVs won, which were built by Shelby and Holman and Moody mechanics at Carcraft up in Detroit. In 66, we finished first, second, and third with the GT40 Mark II, which is similar to the car we have behind me. It's fun for me because I was there. Yeah. It's kind of nice to have been there 40 years ago and still have one to drive around today and vintage race it show it and play with it.
It sounds like you're quite a lucky guy. The car that sits beyond us there, could you tell us a little bit about that?
The GT40 Mark II is a standard 427 built to the same specifications that we ran at Le Mans 1966. Now the Mark IIs had a standard 427 single four barrel engine. They were capable of 230 miles an hour down the Mulsanne straightaway. They would run for 24 hours without failing. The beauty of the GT40 Mark II is it's the most engineered car of its day, but it didn't have computers, ground effects, wings, turbochargers. It's a steel chassis. It's the last real race car that has a perfect chassis setup. It is perfectly balanced, but it doesn't have to have any of the computers or carbon fiber or any of the things of the modern technology. And all of the drivers refer to the GT40s as a family as the last really fun car to drive. It's just a beautiful car.
And you have fun with this one.
Oh, I have a lot of fun with it. I've raced it at Elkhart Lake, at Daytona, Watkins Glen. I'm taking it out to California in a couple of months to go play at the Shelby convention. It's just a real fun race car. Very comfortable to drive, very easy to drive. At 150 miles an hour in it, you feel like you're doing about 70 down the interstate. There's no drama, there's no intrigue. Where I have a little Ferrari road car, the 1960 style Ferrari, that is state of the art for that period, and at 90 miles an hour in it, you feel like you're going to die because you don't know where it's going or what it's going to do. It's still pretty, it's still fun to drive, but the GT40, everybody that gets in a Mark II GT40 gets out saying that it's the most wonderful car they ever drove.
I have never driven one myself, but I think that it's the most beautiful car in the world, actually. How about the other one, the Ford Fairlane sitting beside it? What's that?
We kind of call that the son of the beast. In 1964, Holman and Moody wanted to take a Ford Fairlane and run it in a sports car race, and so we built one up with a 427 engine, and Fireball Roberts drove it at Daytona and finished second to A.J. Foyt in a Cooper Monaco. And so there was a historical precedent for a 64 Ford Fairlane to race in a sports car race. And a customer in Germany requested that we get permission from the FIA to build some more. And to our surprise, we didn't expect the FIA to go along with it, but they did, and they encouraged us to do more. And so we have built this up as a copy of the original Fireball Roberts car. It has a 427 Ford engine with two four barrels. It has the 12-inch vented disc brake rotors with NASCAR front suspension, 10-inch wide wheels and tires, fiberglass body panels. We sell them for about $180,000 ready to race, but it's an absolute rocket ship because it has the same engine as the GT40 Mark II. It has all the same components. It's just a front engine rear-wheel drive, where the GT40 is the midship engine rear-wheel drive car. But it's a lot of fun. It's too quick for what it's supposed to be. It's extremely fast.
It's a delicate problem.
Yeah.
Too quick.
Yeah, you really want to run second until just before the checkered flag. And unfortunately, this car can lap the field.
Okay, so if anybody would feel like spending $180,000 for a historic race car that laps the field, guaranteed,
yeah.
They could get in touch with you then.
They could. This one's for sale.
Yeah, and they could look you up at the internet.
Yes, we have a website. It's holmanmoody.com.
And you can find everything there, I guess.
Yes.
Could we take a little closer look on the GD40 and maybe hear that wonderful music?
Sure.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome. Let's see if it fires.
Yeah. Let's give it a try.
That's important about the cars, when the Mark II's race, because Holman and Moody was in charge of the project,
yes.
They had Holman and Moody serial numbers on them. So we are the manufacturer of record of the Mark II GT40s.
Ah, okay.
So this is a new Mark II,
oh, yeah.
But it's real because we built it.
Yeah, so it's in the right series and the right chassis yeah. And everything.
And the fun part for me personally is, I was a big fan of Mark Donohue.
Yeah.
And I knew Ken Miles, and I know Dan Gurney, and I knew all the drivers. But I have all the original race records, and so I can set this car up exactly the way Mark Donohue liked his, and exactly the way Ken Miles liked his. And that's what's fun for me, is to be able to drive Mark Donohue's Mark II.
That's right. Exactly.
Or Ken Miles' Mark II.
That's perfect. As they were when they raced.
Yeah, and that's what this is.
The only difference is, well, you've got the tires that are blue streaks, so they're basically the same tires.
Yeah. Yeah, everything's the same. All the corner weights are the same. Everything's identical to the original.
Yeah.
For this car to be eligible for FIA, I could not make any improvements. There's no upgrades. There's no new version of this. It's exactly the way we raced at Le Mans 66. Well,
yeah.